It's time for Speed 77 Radio's Motorsports Madness, powered by the staff at Race Chaser Online. Today's racing news, yesterday's racing history, and now here are your hosts, Jacob Seelman, Tom Baker, and Kyle Magda.
I will warn you right off, if you have a seatbelt, you may want to fasten it for this edition of Motorsports Madness, because you are about to hear some of the wildest and craziest antics I think we've ever gotten into on this show over the next 2 hours. And I will just leave the disclaimer right at that. Good evening, everybody, and welcome to this edition of Motorsports Madness, as Tom Baker is quietly ribbing me to my left. I'm Jacob Seelman, along with the rest of our cast and crew, Kyle Magda, James Pike here at the round table. And Tom, I'm just at a loss for this weekend. There were some good things, there were some bad things, and then I'm just going to be honest, there was some downright ugly stuff this weekend. It was ridiculous.
Well, I think I know where you're going with the ugly, and we'll save that for just a little while to when we open the Open Wheel Central and talk about the Jambalaya Mid-South Brunswick stew of an event that the Indy race at NOLA was. I have some definitive thoughts on that, and I've read a lot of other people's opinions and their analysis of it, and of course we'll have Joel Sebastianelli, who was on hand at the event doing his duties for the normal TV series that he's involved with Mazda Road to Indy, and he'll be talking to us as well about his thoughts. But you know what? It was an interesting weekend. Let's put it that way. If anybody watched any amount of racing over the weekend and calls the weekend boring, I'm not sure what they were looking at, because it was anything but that. NASCAR had a couple of interesting shows at Texas, and we certainly saw some interesting racing where we were. So we'll talk about all of that as the day goes on. And of course, we have Eric Riggins Jr. coming on the show a little while from now, Jacob. And Eric got the broom out and swept the Carolina Tour for the USCS series, which wasn't a great surprise to me, because that's usually what he does when they all show up here. But, man, that kid is just strong. I mean, he knows how to do it.
Yeah, he does know how to do it. And we will get to that when we get to our dirt topics a little bit later on in the show. Steve Ovens will be on hand to help us break all that down. James Pike, on the other hand, I have a couple of words that could describe what I saw on Saturday night at Texas for the Sprint Cup Series. One would be runaway, the second would be thievery, and the third would be a pair of words that I call six time.
Yeah, you know, I will probably remember who said this on Twitter earlier today when I was just perusing around the interwebs, as I call them, and someone out there mentioned the idea that Texas is about at the spot where I think California was a few years back, where maybe mm-hmm. their product might be a little bit better if you let that surface wear out a little bit more and shorten the race by about 100 miles. The more I think about that, the more I wonder if that might not be the worst thing in the world, although in fairness, the end of the race was interesting. But yeah, it was a runaway by a handful of guys for a good chunk of the evening, and that's well and all and okay, I guess, every once in a while, but it does kind of get to be a drag if it happens too much.
Yeah, and Kyle Magda, I'm a little bit ill with the finish of that cup race, because I had Kevin Harvick, who arguably had the best car over the last 250 miles of that race, and my argument is he got robbed. I don't know where Jimmy Johnson came from at the end of that one, but a couple of funky-looking debris cautions and one big shot to Joey Logano later. Here comes the 48, and bye-bye goes the 4.
Yeah, pretty much looking like Atlanta right there, you know, with Jimmy Johnson and Kevin Harvick. Seemed like they just can't get away from each other. But, yeah, I mean, I really didn't get to see the cup race. I was at a racetrack myself, and I'm very thankful for that. A little chilly, but, you know, everything went well. But, yeah, I mean, a 48 team, I mean, they have not slowed down since the season have started. They have been strong on the mile and a half. So is Kevin Harvick. I mean, they've been the two dominant cars right now. Same thing at Las Vegas. It was pretty much Kevin Harvick and then Jimmy Johnson for the longest time. And then Jimmy had that issue. So, yeah, those two are pretty much in a league of their own right now when it comes to the mile and a halfs.
James just slipped me a note across the table that said Taco Gate. Is that what they determined that piece of debris was? A taco wrapper, James? Really?
Yeah. I mean, I guess stranger things have happened. I really don't know what to make of that, to be honest. Beyond the fact that we may or may not be able to blame Michael Waltrip for that. I don't know. But
Michael eating the taco? Is that...
Well, I believe, what was it not he who opened the taco on Denny Hamlin's deck lid? I could be wrong about that.
Yes. But yeah.
Okay. All right. So that much we know for certain, I think. Everything else is just kind of up in the air in a very nebulous place, as far as I'm concerned.
Okay.
Nebulous. That's a good start.
That's a new word for the day. Tom, on that note, we'll go from big words to big numbers. And my big number is 2, by the fact that 2 is the number of wins that Jimmy Johnson has for the 2015 season. 2 is also the number of wins that it takes to lock yourself into the chase if he qualifies for the remaining 19 races and finishes in the top 30 in points. Sounds simple enough. 6 times going back to fight for another championship.
Well, he's got 2 wins, so obviously, yeah, that puts him in the fight for the championship. Again, I think it's a little early to be drawing any conclusions about the 48 being the favorite or the 48's back or... I don't think the 48 really ever left. I mean, other teams got better. We've been talking all year about Stewart Haas and not Hendrick as much. And now Jimmy Johnson goes to a track where Hendrick notoriously has done well. And he does well and wins a race. I mean, and Kevin Harvick was right in the thick of it. And Joey Logano was right in the thick of it for a while. And, you know, you had some other guys as well. It's good to see the 48 back in the mix, because I do think when Jimmy's contending and running well every week, I think it raises a lot of people's level of interest, whether you hate him or you love him. And I don't know too many people who hate Jimmy. I think people just there are numbers of people who don't want to see him keep winning championships. So I think Jimmy is a driver you want in the mix, because I think it's more interesting when he's racing for wins. So certainly I think the story of the year so far would have to be Jimmy Johnson and Kevin Harvick, as we've stated. But there are a number of other drivers who have had great starts to the season, haven't necessarily had the best results to show, but they're fast. And, you know, I think as we get into the meat of the schedule a little bit, you know, you got Bristol coming up, you got Richmond coming up, you got Charlotte coming up in a month or so. You know, a lot of these tracks are tracks where those guys run well, but where other guys also run well. And I think you're going to see some more of the competition come to the forefront and start seeing some other winners. I don't think this is going to be a season dominated by 2 or 3 cars.
Yeah. Kyle Magda, can I throw you some numbers? I know you like numbers.
Yeah, I do. You and I are just like, that's how we gel, man.
Yes, that's how we gel. Okay, I'll throw you a few numbers. Jimmy Johnson has now won 4 of the last 6 races in Texas, but the win on Saturday night was his first spring race victory. He's got 72 all-time, which coincidentally is creeping closer and closer and closer to a certain teammate of his who hasn't won yet and only has about 20 more of them. I'm not willing to say anything just yet, but I heard some people starting to make the argument that Jeff Gordon's place in history isn't safe retiring when he is.
Well, I mean, for Jeff, I think when he's thinking about it, he wants to be competitive while he's going out, because you saw that with Richard Petty, you know, getting his last win in 1984. I mean, he did have some good runs over his last 8 years or so, but still not really what I think he would have liked. Of course, a couple more wins, but just didn't happen. But yeah, I mean, Jimmy still has a lot ahead of him right now. I mean, he's like Tom said, that team really hasn't left. You know, everybody's been catching up. But what the 48 team is doing right now, like I said, they're doing great in a mile and a half right now. And They've been showing it at other tracks as well. That's how Jimmy Johnson is in Chad Knaus. They're good at every single place, not just the big tracks, but the short tracks as well.
Yeah, this is true. But Tom said the story of the season wasn't just Jimmy Johnson and Kevin Harvick. James, I have to disagree. Kevin Harvick finished second on Saturday night. That was his ninth top two finish in the last 10 races going back to Texas last fall, discounting an eighth place finish at Martinsville. And I don't know how you even discount a top 10 in the Sprint Cup Series, because we know how hard to come by those are. Is there any reason to even begin to doubt the four team for anything yet?
Well, doubt them? No, we understand that they're good on mile and a half tracks, and they're as
good everywhere else.
Well, I'm getting there, but namely the mile and a half program. That's really been their big calling card if you look back at last year as well. But at the same time, you also have to understand that, if I can do math, I believe we still have 29 points races left in the season. So it's not like you could shoe them in for anything either, because a lot can change between now and April. Right, Tom?
That's exactly right. And that is not what I said, Jacob. What I said was that although we've started the season talking about Stewart Haas more so than Hendrick, yes, Kevin Harvick and Jimmy Johnson each have a couple of wins, but all I said was there are many other drivers who have been fast and just haven't had the finish results to show for it. Jeff Gordon's ended up in the fence two or three times. Joey Logano's run up front plenty. Denny Hamlin's been up front. You've had Keselowski up front at different times and just hasn't had every week. This is not, it's lopsided because they've been running a lot of tracks that Kevin Harvick is very good at. I don't think for one second that this is going to be a season dominated by those two cars. That's all I said, is as we go down the road, you're going to see other winners. This is going to end up being a year just like every other, where we have 7, 8, 10, 12 different winners. And, you know, we're fighting for one or two chase spots at the end on points. And so I did not say that, but just said that those two have been the story up to now, maybe, but not, I'm not seeing that going down the road. It's not going to be a dominant season for either of them.
I'll make an argument to your point on Kevin Harvick in just a minute, but I'm glad you brought out the Penske boys, because I'm going to talk about them in just a minute. Right now, we're going to take a turn and a caution flag. When we come back, more of the madness right here on the Performance Motorsports Network.
How would you like to win a brand new Corvette? Larry O's got all the details.
WinYourNewCar.com, enter America's number one dream car giveaway contest. At WinYourNewCar.com, complete the puzzle the fastest and win a new Corvette tax-free. Come on, stop dreaming. Start driving with WinYourNewCar.com.
You hear that? That's the sound of America's only sports car. That's right, it's a Corvette. But not just any Corvette. It's your Corvette. It's that who cares if there's traffic part of your day. And this can be you when you come to Cooper Corvettes. With 60 years of Corvettes to choose from, there's always a Corvette in your budget. And they'll service any Corvette you bring in. Cooper Corvettes on Route 1 just north of Quantico and Triangle. Call, click, or visit CooperCorvettes.com.
Hi, this is Yen Scott from Summit Point Kart in Summit Point, West Virginia. If you're looking for a real racing experience on a real racetrack, come out to Summit Point Kart this weekend. For as little as $25, you can get your racing career started. New this year, Summit Point Kart offers the RX250 capable of over 75 miles an hour. We're open every Friday from 5 p.m. till 9 p.m., Saturday from noon till 10 p.m., and Sunday from noon till 9 p.m. For more information, go to our website, summitpointkartwithak.com, or you can call us at 304-725-5270. Summit Point Kart, your East Coast karting center.
In the race of everyday life, it's nice to have the green flag, but drivetrain problems are the pits. A fully remanufactured engine, transmission, or differential from Jasper Engines and Transmissions costs less than a new vehicle and comes with a 3-year, 100,000-mile nationwide transferable warranty. See jasperengines.com for details and get the green flag in your race of everyday life.
See the boys at Chandler & Sons Automotive, 45977 Old Ox Road in Sterling. Give them a call, 703-437-7300.
Did you know that birthday parties help build confidence in kids?
Yeah. Did you know that giving kids less sugar before bedtime helps them sleep better?
Oh, totally. Did you know that friendly kids have more friends?
Everybody knows that.
Hey, guys, did you know that most people think they're using the right car seat for their kid, but they're not?
I didn't know that.
Parents who really know it all know for sure that their child is in the right car seat at the right age and size. Visit safercar.gov/the right seat to make sure your child is protected. Brought to you by the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration.
Packers.
Vikings.
Red State.
Blue State.
We come from different places.
Uptown.
Downtown.
We come to different conclusions.
Half empty.
Half full.
But no matter how different we are, we're all connected, and we can all make a difference. That's why United Way brings people, expertise, and resources together to improve the education, income, and health of our communities, the building blocks for a better life. When we live united, our efforts, magnified by others, add up to real change. Children succeed in school, families gain financial stability, the health of our neighbors improves, and suddenly, so do our communities. But real change won't happen without you.
Live united.
So let's look beyond our differences.
Live united.
One by one, let's make a difference. Let's reach out a hand to one and influence the condition of all.
Live united.
Give, advocate, volunteer. Live United. Sign up today at liveunited.org. Brought to you by United Way and the Ad Council.
We now return you to 2.5 Men on Speed 77 Radio's Motorsports Madness on the Performance Motorsports Network.
And hey, we're still trying to figure out the half, but that's because the one, two, how many ever of us they are, none of us have ever been very good at math. I think we all, Tom, were like asleep or something during that time of the day in school. At least I was.
Yeah, I think so. Anyways, let's move on here. You were going to make a point about Penske.
I was going to make a point about Penske. And it starts, James Pike, with a point about Harvick. Because Kevin's a little bit irritated. And you know what? After I watched a replay of the end of Saturday night, I can see why. Joey Logano was blocking Harvick about as hard as he was blocking Tony Stewart at Fontana a couple years ago. And we all know what happened after that.
You know, I tried to watch replays on this, and there's a part of me that says, yes, blocking is blocking. There's another part of me that says, but at the same time, racing is racing. And if you have to do that kind of thing, it makes me think of what Tony said to Denny. What was that? I think the 2011 fall race when Tony was about to go a lap down and Tony was racing the ever living daylights out of Denny for the win. And he said, you know, I'm sorry, I had to race the blankety blank out of Denny to make sure I didn't go a lap down. It's not quite the same situation, but I think it's the same principle that applies. And to be honest, I really don't know if I've found any sort of ground or standing one way or the other as far as this situation goes. Jacob?
Oh, I don't know about that, Tom. I mean, goodness. Logano, Harvick, it seems like we've heard that story before as far as a feud in the Cup Series.
Kevin Harvick. It's amazing to me how Kevin Harvick loves to whine about other drivers. He really needs to be sponsored by Kleenex. Joey Logano was racing for position. Kevin Harvick will run you just as hard. He'll run through you, over you, around you. I mean, shoot, he hopped over a car to get to Ricky Rudd a bunch of years ago. It's a really good thing Rudd didn't get a hold of him. I mean, you know, I love Kevin as a racer. He's one of the best drivers on the circuit, bar none. He's as good as Tony. He's as good as anybody out there right now. He's at the top of his game, and he's got a great team around him. But you know what, Kevin? Stop it. Joey races people hard. Joey also admitted after the race, if I were Kevin, I probably would have done exactly what Kevin did. But what choice do I have? If I don't block him, I lose the position and probably six more. So Kevin just needs to stop whining and stop complaining about things and just run races. I don't buy any of it. Joey Logano may have blocked him or whatever, but you know what? Until somebody takes it from you, it's your spot. So if somebody's going to close the door hard, you have a right to move them out of the way. But for goodness sake, I mean, don't make it sound like you never do anything like that, because, I mean, there's plenty of footage out there to go around. Kevin and Joey is a good feud, though. I will say that much. It's been entertaining all year. And I like that Joey doesn't back down from him. I think it's great.
I can't help but think about who wears the fire suit in the family. Can
yeah,
we go
exactly.
back to that?
Delana needs to get the t-shirts back.
Oh, let's do that. Anyway, Kyle Magda, I want to go to a smile subject for a minute. And you know what? Friday night, as opposed to Saturday night, made me smile a whole heck of a lot. Because while Tom can sit to my left and whine and complain about as bad as Kevin Harvick did all day long about Cup guys coming down and winning Xfinity races, I don't think there's a soul in the world that can complain about a guy coming up and winning an Xfinity race. Hello, Eric Jones.
I guess Tom's prediction of Cup drivers winning the rest of the season in Xfinity when they're entered, it didn't work out, huh?
Thank God. It's nice to see that every once in a while, a real Xfinity racer still gets an Xfinity win.
Well, technically, he's a truck racer, Tom.
Yeah, but he's still part-time Xfinity. I'm just saying, you know, I mean, you guys can disagree if you want. That's what makes the show, and that's why everybody has a different opinion. I don't like Cup drivers going down and cleaning house the other series because it takes away for the guys who were trying to get the notoriety for their sponsors to go up. I love that Eric Jones won, although I think the idea of putting him in the Cup car, as I read in a couple of posts today, anytime soon is a little premature, but you know, nonetheless, it'll probably happen because, you know, that's what somebody wants to happen. I think we're getting a little ahead of ourselves on that, but I'm happy for him. You know, Junior gave him a good run, but Eric had more than enough to hold everybody off. When at the end, it was like he grabbed another gear and went and just had it to himself. Good for him and good for Gibbs.
Mm-hmm. And guys, yeah. Something that I actually saw was, you know, Eric Jones won Friday night, got his first win. It was kind of reminiscent from last year's spring at the time Chase. Nationwide Series race with Chase Elliott. Just drove away from everybody in the end, got his first win. And guys, I remember seeing these two drivers, Chase Elliott, Eric Jones. They finished 1-2 in the Pocono ARCA race back in June of 2013. And wouldn't you know it, both of them get their first Xfinity win at Texas and in the spring race as well.
Fair enough. It's just fun to sit and watch and see all these little things play out. And I don't think Eric Jones is done. We saw him win 3 truck races before he ever went full time. And now he's full time in the truck series. And I can't wait to see what he does with that, with a part-time Xfinity schedule. Gee, Tom, he's getting pretty good at winning races as a part-timer. I don't know that he's won a race in the truck series yet since he's been full-time. Every win in all of the top-level series he's been in so far has been as a part-time driver.
Well, you know, I don't think it takes a full-time effort for a talented driver to win a race. He's in equipment that's as good as anything out there in each of those series. And I think that helps a lot when you have a situation like that where you know the car or the truck is there for you. And Eric is definitely a supremely talented racer. I just hope that Gibbs does not make the same mistake they made with Joey Logano and rush him to Cup. Joey went way too soon, and I hope they will just take it easy with Eric, like Hendrick has done with Chase Elliott, and, you know, let him grow into Xfinity for a season or two before, you know, they decide to move him. By then, I'm sure somebody out of the veteran Cup group they've got is going to be ready to go somewhere else. And then at that point, you've got an opening for him to slide up and run in the top series. But he certainly is a very talented racer, and I'm happy to see him get the win.
But yeah, and it was fun. It was a change of pace, and that's the thing I like most about this. So, James Pike, I'll turn to you now for another vent topic for a minute, because one other thing I noticed between Friday and Saturday, and somebody said it on Twitter, I don't remember who it was, but the fact that you can look at Friday night's Xfinity race and see Eric Jones just wax the floor in the closing laps with everybody in a Joe Gibbs car, and yet on Sunday, where are the Toyotas again? Whatever Toyota is doing, they need to take what they're doing on Xfinity days and truck days and apply it where it really matters. Because right now, I'm just going to be point blank. They suck in the Cup Series. Not quite as bad as Roush Fenway, but pretty close.
Yeah, and I think we're at the point where you really start wondering, well, what exactly is the problem? You've got multiple options. You could say maybe it's something they're doing at Gibbs that isn't quite working out. Maybe it's something that they're doing with the engines at the TRD shops in California that needs changing. I don't know if we can say here in our position that we have all of the answers and know exactly why Toyota is struggling so much, but I think you look at one of those two places, either the team or the engine shop, since TRD handles all the engines for Cup, and I would like to think that somewhere in there, Tom, well, we might get an answer to why Toyota's been struggling so much.
Well, I don't know that they've exactly been struggling that much. I think we're overrating this a little bit. I mean, Denny Hamlin has been up front several times this year.
I discount the fact that he won at Martinsville because it's a short track, and you can knock somebody out of the way all day to win a short track race. I'm talking about everywhere else where speed matters.
Fast, you got to take the 18 car out of the equation because David Reagan's been driving it, and Carl Edwards is a new team. So yes, they certainly have issues. Don't want to say they suck. Now Roush Fenway sucks. I mean, they're not even close. Texas is a track where Roush notoriously has been very successful, and they weren't even in the ballpark. I mean, you know, they've got big time issues over there, and I don't know if they have a clue even of a direction on how to solve them. It doesn't seem to be getting better. But I don't know that I would say Gibbs sucks. They're certainly off their game. But, you know, it's tough anymore because you've got so much competition now in the Cup Series that, you know, sometimes it's not about results as much as performance. And, you know, some of this has been just bad luck, too. I don't know that I'm ready to write Gibbs off. They certainly have work to do for sure. But when you factor a new team, a substitute driver that, you know, while David is a great guy and all, he's not Kyle Busch. And, you know, and then you got two cars that have been fast at more places than just Martinsville. They just haven't won races. And you factor in a hot hand with Kevin Harvick. I mean, you know, let's let some more of the season go by and see what happens the next four or five races before we write Joe Gibbs off as saying they suck. I think that's a little harsh.
Fair enough. I'll take a step back, but they are last in manufacturer points. So anyway, with that being said, we're going to shift rants now. And when we come back, Joel Sebastianelli is going to pop by the round table and we're going to have a lot of fun. You're listening to Motorsports Madness right here on the Performance Motorsports Network.
How would you like to win a brand new Corvette? Larry O's got all the details.
Enter America's number one dream car giveaway contest at winyournewcar.com. That's right, winyournewcar.com. Complete the puzzle the fastest and win a new Corvette tax-free delivered to your door. Come on, stop dreaming and start driving with winyournewcar.com.
We're growing like crazy and need account reps who know their way around agencies, the internet, and social media. Got connections? Or do you know how to get to the decision makers? Are you fearless? We need you. Internet radio, or as we call it, wireless mobile radio, is rapidly becoming the place to be with almost limitless income potential. So contact us to get involved with the fastest growing professionally produced group of internet radio stations in the world. Your imagination is the only limit here. Call 717-749-0444. That's 717-749-0444. Or you can email us at scorpionradiogroup@gmail.com. You want to ask for Sue.
So you finally arrived at the sweet spot in your life. The kids are raised and gone. You have free time, and it's finally time to do something for you. If you've ever considered owning a Corvette but have been putting it off for years, now is the time to act. Isn't this the time to finally get that Corvette you always wanted and drooled and dreamed over? Well, grab the little lady by the hand and take her to Cooper Corvettes. They're conveniently located on Route 1 just off of I-95 and just north of the Marine Corps base. They have lots of pampered and well-maintained Corvettes in inventory, and if they don't have what you want, they'll find it. From classic Stingrays to modern-day cars, Cooper is your one-stop shop. And speaking of shops, they service what they sell. And even if you didn't buy a Cooper Corvette, they'll service your Corvette anyway. Become part of the Cooper Corvette family. Call them at 703-445-1483. That's 703-445-1483. And on the web at coopercorvettes.com. That's coopercorvettes.com, American pride and countrywide.
You wouldn't trust your taxes to an uncertified accountant. So why trust your vehicle to an uncertified technician? You have to take your car into the shop. Look for the blue and white ASE sign. That ASE blue seal means the shop employs technicians certified by the National Institute for Automotive Service Excellence. ASE certification is proof that technicians have the knowledge and experience to fix your vehicle right the first time. For more information on finding an ASE Blue Seal of Excellence facility, visit the website at www.ase.com.
Hi, this is Carl Edwards here for RAD, the entertainment industry's voice for road safety. You want to make a difference? It's simple. Be responsible. Plan ahead. Designate before you celebrate. Friends don't let friends drive drunk.
Maybe you can drive my car. Yes, I'm gonna be a star.
A public service message brought to you by the U.S. Department of Transportation, RAD, the National Association of Broadcasters, and the Ad Council.
Time now for Open Wheel Central with our resident wine and cheeser, Joe Sebastianelli. Here to pop the cork is Race Chaser Online's managing editor, Jacob Seelman.
Oh, do I have a feeling there's going to be a lot of whining in this segment. And you know what? I think that's going to make it very fun. Welcome back to Motorsports Madness, Jacob Seelman and Joel Sebastianelli and Tom Baker and James Pike, seated around the round table with our wine and our cheese and our crackers and a very incensed Joel. I think that would be tame, maybe. I don't know. Joel, do you want me to just cut right to the chase, or should we start and spare the listeners for a couple minutes by talking about China, which was far more boring?
Yeah, you know, it wasn't the greatest weekend for open wheel racing now, was it? Why don't we get the IndyCar out of the way right now? Because I think that that's the real burning topic, seeing as Formula One didn't give us much to talk about at all.
No, it did not. Okay, Joel, I'm just going to be very point blank about this. What I witnessed on Sunday afternoon was described best by five letters that I will put like this. It was a farce. It was terrible. I don't know what everybody was thinking when we had a monsoon at like 9 a.m. Sunday morning, and it was looking as bad as it was. I don't know why you don't just call everything then and move it to Monday, but they tried to dry the track, and I will admit they did a decent job at it for, I don't know, the first 15 laps until the rains came back again, and then everybody lost their minds. What on earth? Did everybody just take leave of their bodies behind the wheel of these Indy cars? I don't know.
Maybe not their bodies, their minds perhaps. I'm impressed that that's the F word you chose, farce. It certainly was a farce. It would, it was a mess for a lot of reasons, and you have to give the event the benefit of the doubt to a certain extent based on weather, because there were a lot of issues there. You know, first of all, attendance, parking, things that happen with a club venue that's never hosted an IndyCar event. A lot of those are going to be first-time pains. I suppose some of that is natural, and the fact that there was such terrible weather, a monsoon on Sunday morning, definitely didn't help things. One of the Pro Mazda races had to be canceled because of the amount of water and the weather. And with everything else happening on Sunday, IndyCar had to be the main concern. There wasn't as much racing action, I think, as fans would have liked. And a lot of that has to do with weather. And we've had some one-off weather catastrophes like that in IndyCar before. You know, New Hampshire is one of the most recent ones that comes to mind, starting
them up
a few years ago in the rain. And it was a mess, but you know, maybe it shouldn't have been a one and done, because the things that happened, it wasn't all to do with the venue, and some of it is just a freak accident of sorts. You can't control the weather like that. So I'll give NOLA Motorsports Park the benefit of the doubt, and I think that perhaps, you know, maybe if they can work out some of those problems with the event, whatever they were, then maybe this event has a future, because I thought the track itself was fairly good. They need to fix the drainage on the track. But a lot of this had to do with drivers, too. I mean, think about it. Of all of the time we spent under yellow, and there was a lot of time under yellow.
26 of the last 32 laps, Joel. That's ridiculous.
And only 31 minutes of the race under green. But not all of that was just because it was too wet and they were trying to dry the track. We saw multiple incidents. We saw Ryan Hunter-Reay and Simon Pagenaud doing I don't even know what three wide and a portion of the track where perhaps you shouldn't even be too wide with Bourdais caught as an innocent bystander. You have Draconi being Draconi and sliding through the opposite direction through the pits and clobbering a crew member. You know, these guys are right. Power Bourdais, you know, everybody after the race who, Bourdais in particular, who said, listen, you know, we just need to drive better. Nobody deserved what happened. I think it was a rough weekend for everybody. Everybody deserves a small slice of the blame. This was definitely not IndyCar's one shining moment at all.
Okay, so Joel, I have a couple of questions. First of all, wasn't it the Pro Mazda class that ran in a driving rainstorm? Was that on Saturday, or was that the two? Didn't one of the underclasses run a caution free race in rain?
Pro Mazda did on Sunday morning.
Okay.
Saturday night there was way too much rain. That had to be moved because of everything with IndyCar.
Okay, so I just wanted to establish the fact that the less experienced drivers in a driving rainstorm went caution free. The drivers who are supposed to be the best in the world, in terms of, I guess, IndyCar anyway, the guys who are supposed to know what they're doing, absolutely drove with their heads square up their asses and just simply didn't take into account the conditions. Now, I sense that there was a lot of dispute about some of the you know, the things you mentioned, the logistical nightmares, the facility related things. Let's face facts here. We're trying to take a club facility. I thought Robin Miller put it beautifully. This is not a facility that was built to handle a National Series event. This is a club facility. This is a facility built for amateur style race, road racing. I wonder why IndyCar, some of these logistical things that were issues, it would seem to me when you go there and you look at the facility, you have somebody who plots all this out. And so why, if there's all these issues, why weren't they solved by the time winter testing was over with? Why did we not have these things taken care of before race weekend got here?
I'll throw one into the fire to add to that, Joel. Why on earth were we having the drivers, who are supposed to be the ones that this whole deal is about, having to take a 15 or 20 minute shuttle ride just to get to the paddock?
I mean, none of these are answers that I have. You know, I mean, these are all the same questions we've been asking throughout the weekend. All I can say is that the racing itself at NOLA, when we actually raced, was actually fairly good. I was very impressed with the quality of racing. It's just the problem was there was so little of it. So, yes, it was a logistical nightmare in some regards, or in most regards, actually. But all things considered, if the event is about the racing, I think that it has the potential to put on a fairly good show. This was not a good show, though. This was a circus, and IndyCar could not be looking forward to the sunshine in Southern California more than they are right now.
And Joel, I think you did two things. Number one, you used Tom's favorite word, which is circus. And number two, I love how we've spent 10 minutes discussing all of this, and we haven't even gotten to the fact that Simon Pagenaud won a race.
Oh, really? I think Simon Pagenaud had some problems of his own at the end.
James Hinchcliffe. Wow, I'm too off on the rant.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah, close.
Hello.
There's
my moment for the night. I'm off on the rant.
Joel, can you take over while Jake gets his train back on the track?
That was
Please. The
radio equivalent of aquaplaning off track and pulling a, Simon Pagenaud towards the end.
Hinchcliffe, sorry.
Yeah, well, James Hinchcliffe did win, and in some cases, not to take any of the credit away from him, but I suppose it's better to be lucky. And I think they did get a lot of luck. Only one stop, it was a gamble, almost paid off in a Carlos Huerta sort of way from Houston. But for James Hinchcliffe and those guys, I mean, the fact that they could do it in one stop is almost unthinkable. It's because we had so many caution flags. So a crazy race, and Hinchcliffe the beneficiary, and good for him too, only finished 16th in St. Pete. So to jump all the way up to 4th in the standings now, if they can keep some of that momentum going, would be a good thing. Same for James Jakes as well, his teammate finishing in 3rd on one of the other steps of the podium, Elio in 2nd. As far as the drivers up at the top, you know, some of the big names, Honoré, Bourdais, those two taken out by the incident along with Simon Pagenaud. But for the most part, the top drivers from IndyCar, the ones who shine at St. Pete, were at least able to finish up front this time too. Tony Kanaan pulling off another top 10 in 6th, the top 10 for Will Power in 7th. Elio again with another top 5, while Pablo Montoya rounded out the top 5 this week. So at least with all of the craziness that happened, it didn't seem as though anybody really got caught out and just messed over by the whole deal. If anything, you know, drivers like James Jakes, aided by the weather, able to jump up from his starting spot towards the end of the field in 22nd on entrant points all the way up to 3rd. You know, at least those guys benefited as opposed to anybody just getting messed over. You know, like the Will Power deal, for example, when Power spun out under pace laps. You know, nothing like that happened. So I suppose that's a good thing from the weekend, that as crazy as it all was, I guess it could have been crazier in how it affected everybody points-wise and finishing-wise.
Okay, so can we sum this up into a little bow by saying this? The racing at times was very entertaining, but there were also many times when it wasn't. And also, the facility, if they're going to go back in 2016, they need to sit down and create the environment for a whole lot of improvements to make the second time around much better than the first. You cannot do anything about the weather, but at least the racing itself, these drivers have got to get it together. And can we at least say that there was some good racing, but by and large, as a whole, it was not one of IndyCar's best efforts?
It was not. It was not for anybody. And to their credit, the fans that were there were enthusiastic. But one of the things that actually stood out to me is I took a taxi ride from the airport in order to get to my hotel. And the taxi driver had no idea that there was a race event going on. So promotionally speaking, I think there needs to be a better job done by everybody. I still see, even on a club track, I see tons of potential. But I think that everybody, from the drivers to the series to, you know, the fans in some ways, organizers, I mean, everybody involved with this needs to have learned some valuable lessons for this to become a success. I mean, to their credit, and I'm not just saying this because of my role, I truly believe that this is true. The best racing from the weekend was USF 2000 and Pro Mazda. You know, IMSA Lights had some pretty rough crashes in the rain. You know, some of that's natural, but, you know, it is going to be when you're racing pouring rain like that. But USF 2000 and Pro Mazda, for the most part, didn't put a foot wrong all weekend, you know, whether it was wet or dry. So I think everybody involved needs to just get their act together, learn from these mistakes, and I hope it's just not another one-and-done deal for IndyCar, provided that they can fix everything up.
On that note, now that I've exemplified exactly why we call this show The Madness, I'm going to go get my straitjacket. Joel can go back to his corner. We're going to take a break, and we'll come back for round two in just a moment. You're listening to Motorsports Madness on the Performance Motorsports Network.
How would you like to win a brand new Corvette? Larry O's got all the details.
In the Pits Media is proud to present its newest partner, WinYourNewCar.com. That's right, you now can enter the number one American dream car contest giveaway at WinYourNewCar.com. Complete the puzzle the fastest and win a new Corvette tax-free, delivered to your door. Come on, stop dreaming. Start driving with WinYourNewCar.com.
Did you know that birthday parties help build confidence in kids?
Yeah. Did you know that giving kids less sugar before bedtime helps them sleep better?
Oh, totally. Did you know that friendly kids have more friends?
Everybody knows that.
Hey, guys, did you know that most people think they're using the right car seat for their kid, but they're not?
I didn't know that.
Parents who really know it all know for sure that their child is in the right car seat at the right age and size. Visit safercar.gov/the right seat to make sure your child is protected. Brought to you by the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration and the Ad Council.
Hands can do incredible things. They made every sound in this piece of music. But nothing compares to using them to help save a life. If an adult suddenly collapses, call 911, then push hard and fast in the center of their chest until help arrives. It's called hands-only CPR, and it's recommended by the American Heart Association. Visit handsonlycpr.org today. A message from the American Heart Association and the Ad Council.
Car problems? You can trust your local Cottman man. Cottman has a 40-year history as a leader in car repair and making happy, satisfied customers. Whatever's wrong with your car, SUV, or truck, Cottman will check it out free using state-of-the-art diagnostic equipment. Don't take chances with your car. Bring it to Cottman and let your local Cottman man show you why they are America's transmission and total auto care experts. Visit Cottman.com to download money-saving coupons. Cottman, real service, real fast.
You know that phone call is going to come at the worst possible time, right at the end of the game. Fourth quarter, fourth down, and 1 yard to go. They're piling up, but you can't watch that. You got to get that car off the road. This could have been prevented if you have taken advantage of Cottman's free TransCheck 21. Here's a chance to have us look at your car and head off any problems that could happen that could interrupt that game. Again, it's a free check. Come see us.
See Leonard and the fine folks at Cottman of Manassas, 9113 Mathis Avenue in Manassas. Give them a call at 703-365-7200.
All I wanted to do was just pick up a guitar and sing praise songs.
From IamSecond.com.
Well, when I got to 17, I was playing in after-hours bars, just in a bunch of trouble.
Grammy Award winner Michael W. Smith.
Smoking that first joint and feeling so guilty about it. From there, it was LSD, and your compass sort of just like disappeared. I knew where I belonged. I just couldn't get out. I was very depressed. I went on the floor and just began to shake. And I was just weeping. I was weeping. And I just began to just cry out for God. 12:30 at night, on the linoleum floor of my kitchen, the God of the universe came and wept with me on that floor. I know where my hope lies. It's not being a rock star. I'm a son of the High King of the universe.
Watch Michael's story at IamSecond.com.
Let's throw the green for Open Wheel Central on Motorsports Madness. Back to Jacob, the crew, and the only racing insider to ever use Snuggies for Dogs in a conversation about IndyCar, Joel Sebastianelli.
Well, I think my comment from about 10 minutes ago just took over the lead for number one in the list of crazy things said in the Open Wheel segment from Snuggies for Dogs. But on that note, welcome back to Motorsports Madness. Jacob Seelman, Tom Baker, James Pike, Joel Sebastianelli around the round table. And Joel, okay, so let's get all this straight. Because despite the fact that James Hinchcliffe and not Simon Pagenaud won a race, I still want to give props to the guy who, up until 2 weeks ago, I didn't think still remembered how to drive a road course in an IndyCar too well. Because Juan Pablo, by far and large, had the best car all day long. He started on pole by points, but, you know, he stayed there. He kept his teammate Will Power at bay for most of the deal, and had it not been for strategy, he probably would have and should have won that race.
I mean, Montoya had some very good times before that, too. I think that Montoya is a legitimate title contender. And I will admit, and I don't know if this is true for everybody else, I can't speak for other fans, but for all this talk about the big four at Penske, Montoya was my number four, if I had to rank the four. I think Montoya was a very good driver, a guy who could pick up a couple of victories with Penske, but I wasn't sure about a title. Wow. He has a 10-point lead right now. And, you know, again, not that he's not a title caliber driver. I just would have ranked him below the other three. I mean, you have Will Power, the guy who's the defending champion. Simon Pagenaud, who racing in the 77 with Schmidt-Peterson was, you know, not one of the top funded teams and still was competing up there for top fives and victories with the big dogs, with the best of them. Elio, who's been around forever, still seeking that first title. You know, I just think that on a list of the top six or seven IndyCar drivers, Montoya might be on that list, but I would have ranked him as number four within the team. So
interesting.
It surprised me in some ways, and it really shouldn't have. I feel guilty saying that it does. But for Juan Pablo Montoya to see this resurgence with 1 year completely under his belt now, with the victory at at Pocono. I mean, with everything for Juan Pablo Montoya, it's like it's all started coming together consistently now. And this is going to be very interesting for the rest of the season within that team. Right now, the top three in points, all Penske guys. Almost like the inverse order of the way I would have ranked them. Juan Pablo, Elio, Will Power, the top three, with Pagano way down in 10th position in points now. So for Penske, I think Montoya is really going to be one to watch for the title, and I'm not sure I would have said that a couple weeks ago.
Ow. Okay. I make note of that right now, that Joel thinks Juan Pablo could be a contender for the title. I wasn't ready to go quite that far, but hey, I'll take it. I'll definitely take that. There's a reason I picked him last Monday night, and, you know, he came through fairly decently, you know, barring Elio's whole strategy deal and everything. But I digress. One more quick note, Joel, that I want to get to. You brought it up a little bit during our conversation about the driving rainstorm, but I think I have one more word to describe the tail end of that IndyCar race, and that was the last three laps or so when we had the Hunter Ray, Pagano, Bourdais incident. I basically equated that to Tom earlier today as a bowling match. And strike!
My favorite tweet that I think best epitomized the weekend from Tony DiZinno with Motorsports Talk and NBC. He said, "Perhaps fitting that IndyCar debut in New Orleans is akin to a drunk walking through Bourbon Street." Seen that on multiple sides, been there at the racetrack. I've seen it all, and that's about as accurate as it gets. Although the drunks at Bourbon Street have to sober up at some point. So as long as they come back sober for next year, I think that, you know, we can get a lot out of the event, but everyone's got to learn something and put the best foot forward for Long Beach and then for 2016 if the event happens again.
Yes, agreed. Oh, by the way, there was a Formula One race in China. Lewis Hamilton won.
Yeah, he did, and that's not so much a surprise, I guess, right? This was a parade race. And, you know, I'm always one of the first ones to defend Formula One. You know, look, you're going to have stinkers like that everywhere, all right? Every single racing series has them. And you could make the argument that, you know, even though people will rip on F1 for it, F1 has a higher percentage of exciting races, I think, than a lot of other series out there in the world right now. For China, though, I really like the track. Did not particularly care for this race. After some of the excitement in those opening laps, only a couple of positions actually swapped in the top 10. There was very little passing up front. The biggest story of the weekend was Nico Rosberg complaining that the race winner was too slow. You know, Mercedes looking after their tires, Hamilton slowing down, you know, being a little bit more conservative. And apparently Nico Rosberg didn't like that and thought that because his teammate was going slow, it took away his chance to win and threatened his battle in the fight with Ferrari Sebastian Vettel. Okay, then. You know, who would have thought? After everything last season, after what I thought was one of the best inter-team rivalries F1 has seen ever, to go from that to Lewis Hamilton thoroughly dominating everything to comments that perhaps Nico Rosberg isn't as mentally there as he has been before. Like, he's lost some of that edge, some of that fight. I don't know if I would go that far just three races in, but Lewis Hamilton is clearly superior so far. And for as far superior as Mercedes has been, they're not even the top two in the standings. Lewis Hamilton's number one, and Rosberg is still 4 points back of Sebastian Vettel, who is currently sitting in second position thanks to his victory in Malaysia. So I don't think that Ferrari, or anybody else for that matter, has enough to challenge Mercedes on a consistent basis. But I wonder whether or not Nico Rosberg has enough to challenge Lewis Hamilton, or if he'll become a triple world champion by running away with this one. Food for thought.
Yeah, definitely some food for thought. And in reviewing everything that happened from the past weekend, I want to go to some quotes that the always entertaining Niki Lauda dropped on us. There are a few expletives that he decided to launch that I'm going to refrain from using here. But there's one thing that he said that stuck out to me. He said that, of course, Lewis bites. He has the talent to bite. That's why he won the world championship last year. That's why he's leading the points right now. But Nico is just as nasty as Lewis is if Nico sees the chance. And there is a large part of me that suspects at some point this season, Nico is going to turn a page and we're going to see a whole new competitive side of him that we haven't seen yet before. And it might get really, really ugly at Mercedes. And for all of the ridiculousness that F1 currently is right now, you know, you might just have to give them this because at least as far as media and made-for-TV drama goes, this is about as good as it's going to get, I think, Jacob.
Yeah, I think this is about as good as it's going to get, too, shockingly. And it's one of those things where you look at this and go, somebody needs to get a boxing bell. I would love if we had that sound effect, by the way. Somebody needs to get us a boxing bell for this because that's about what we're gearing up for, Joel, is Hamilton v. Rosberg round two. I feel like the spark has lit and we're just waiting for it to hit the gasoline again.
Dump more gasoline on it, for crying out loud. Three races in, he's been swept by his teammate. The time to show some of that fight is going to be right now. If you thought that Lewis Hamilton was going slow, team orders, no team orders, whatever the situation, go and pass him. Don't complain about it in the post-race. Go out there and take the fight to Lewis, because so far, Lewis hasn't had much of a fight at all. He has sleptwalk into the ring. So whether or not Nico Rosberg or anybody else can start throwing punches remains to be seen. But the time is now. He's got to step up his game. And if you remember from last season, Bahrain, one of the best races in recent memory. Yeah, the two of them duked it out big time. One of the best battles of the season, if not the best in that battle for the lead. We'll see if there's some sort of repeated history. Lewis won it last year. But if Nico can be as good here as he has been before, I think we could be in for a show. I certainly hope we are anyway.
I just my grammar police button is itching. That would be sleepwalked, Joel. Just clarifying that. That's kind of what I did through that whole F1 segment. Lewis Hamilton's going to run away with this. I really believe he's got everything well in control, Jacob.
Yeah, I tend to agree, but hey, I'm waiting for Sebastian Vettel to say, not so fast, but I digress. Joel, always fun. If you'll forgive me for my one egregious mistake tonight, I'll come back and I'll find you a cookie for next time. I know it's not wine and cheese, but it's something.
Yeah, well, after Bourbon Street and being in New Orleans, I think we could all take a break from the wine for a little while and gear up, get ready for California next week. Thanks for having me on, guys.
We go to Long Beach, we go to Bahrain. That's coming up. Joel, we'll see you next Monday. We'll also see you out there listening in just a moment. Right now, you're listening to Motorsports Madness on the Performance Motorsports Network.
How would you like to win a brand new Corvette? Larry O's got all the details.
WinYourNewCar.com. Enter America's number one dream car giveaway contest at WinYourNewCar.com. Complete the puzzle the fastest and win a new Corvette tax-free. Come on, stop dreaming. Start driving with winyournewcar.com.
We're growing like crazy and need account reps who know their way around agencies, the internet, and social media. Got connections? Or do you know how to get to the decision makers? Are you fearless? We need you. Internet radio, or as we call it, wireless mobile radio, is rapidly becoming the place to be with almost limitless income potential. So contact us to get involved with the fastest growing professionally produced group of internet radio stations in the world. Your imagination is the only limit here. Call 717-749-0444. That's 717-749-0444. Or you can email us at scorpionradiogroup@gmail.com. You want to ask for Sue.
You hear that? That's the sound of America's only sports car. That's right. It's a Corvette. But not just any Corvette. It's your Corvette. It's that who cares if there's traffic part of your day. And this can be you when you come to Cooper Corvettes. With 60 years of Corvettes to choose from, there's always a Corvette in your budget. And they'll service any Corvette you bring in. Cooper Corvettes on Route 1 just north of Quantico and Triangle. Call, click, or visit CooperCorvettes.com.
You wouldn't trust your taxes to an uncertified accountant. So why trust your vehicle to an uncertified technician? When you have to take your car into the shop, look for the blue and white ASE sign. That ASE blue seal means the shop employs technicians certified by the National Institute for Automotive Service Excellence. ASE certification is proof that technicians have the knowledge and experience to fix your vehicle right the first time. For more information on finding an ASE Blue Seal of Excellence facility, visit the website at www.ase.com.
My very first movie, it was called British Terabithia, and that was a film that a lot of kids loved.
From IamSecond.com.
It felt very cool in my heart to know that I did something nice.
Actress Bailey Madison.
I don't want it to be about me, I want it to be about God. Even though you have an Earth Father, He is your Father, that you can say to Him, God, I'm not feeling too well today. Or if it's just, you know, little things like, I feel homesick, or I need you, Lord. I need to feel happiness in my heart. The most important thing is you have to have hope. You have to have faith. God is with you, and God is with you every step of the way. If you give yourself to God and you say, I'm ready to commit myself to you, you will know that God is watching you. He looks down and He goes, I'm very, very happy with what you just did. My name is Bailey Madison, and I am Second.
You're listening to Speed 77 Radio on the Performance Motorsports Network. Now back to Jacob, Tom, and Kyle on Motorsports Madness.
And it has been mad through the first hour, and we have another 60 minutes to go. Welcome back to Motorsports Madness, Crossed Flags. We're halfway home, whatever you want to call it. Jacob Seelman, Tom Baker, Kyle Magda, James Pike around the round table, getting ready to start the second half of this chaos. And Tom, boy, we've gone through NASCAR, we've gone through IndyCar. I have a moment for the NHRA, because they were in Las Vegas over the weekend. And the guy that everybody loves to talk about, or more accurately, the guy that just loves to talk, won the race. Welcome back, John Force.
Yeah, I was sharing with somebody the other day, this, you know, about, well, I want to go interview John Force, but I don't know what to say. I said, you just hold your recorder up and say to John, talk. And that's all you need to do. You'll get a great 6 minutes. That's Kyle, exactly. It's great. It's good to see him get a win, and it's good for business on all ends, because John Force is a legend in the NHRA that once he decides it's actually time to hang it up, he's never going to be replaced. And when he's winning, or at least he's competitive and running for wins, then everybody's focused. Just like Tiger at the Masters yesterday, didn't win, but had a really solid weekend. And people are kind of looking at him again and saying, well, maybe he's back, and that's good for business. So congratulations to John Force. And, you know, what an interesting NHRA season this has been so far, Jacob, really, because you know, you've had some new folks emerge as, you know, winners and do well. And some of the guys, including John Force, that you would expect to be running for wins every week, you know, necessarily have had some problems. So it's kind of been a topsy-turvy season over there, a lot like we've seen in NASCAR with some of the guys like Jeff Gordon, who just, you know, they've run well, just haven't had the results to show for it. It's good to see John back.
Yeah, this is true, and it really is good to see John back. I like it. I'm very much looking forward to seeing if he can continue this role. And oh, by the way, James, not only was it John's 142nd career NHRA victory, extending that record of most in history, it was also his first win since they transitioned back to Ford. Or to Chevrolet. That's twice now. I need to just, I need to go somewhere or something.
We might need to ask for a replacement host at this rate to actually get his facts straight. But regardless, yeah. One thought only on that. You have to believe that somebody in Ford's marketing department is wanting to get their hands on somebody else and rig them dry for leaving John Force Racing now, don't you think?
Yeah, just a little bit. I mean, it was John Force versus Robert Hight in the final. In Chevrolets, I mean, other than the fact that it's a bow tie on the thing instead of a blue oval now, Tom, how is that any different than the last 20? Well, I won't say 20 years because Robert Hight hasn't been driving that long, but how is that any different than the last 10 years?
Well, I don't really know. It's a question that I really would be interested in asking some of these drivers that I really haven't heard answered in any real kind of I know you were sort of putting that out there as jest, but I don't really think it is any different. I mean, whatever it says on the body, the car still runs the same. I'm not sure there's an advantage to anybody's body work over there or anything like that. I think it's all pretty much what it is, but it's just who you're promoting. It is weird to see him doing it with bow tie trim and also not with Castrol, obviously, but great move for Peak, and obviously Chevy took advantage of it, and John's now back in form, and I think it's, like I said, I keep coming back to the fact that when he's winning it doesn't even have to be on a weekly basis, every now and again, once a month, once every 6 weeks, he gets him a win. It's good for business. Everybody's watching. He's just a fun guy, and he's been great for the sport, and I think it's very cool to see him back up there and like I said, getting a victory.
Yes, sir. Very good. And while we're talking about a little bit of obscurity that we love to harp on, and not as much of the rest of the world may pay attention to on a regular basis, Tom, how about let's give a call to Ryan Dungey, who locked up the Monster Energy Supercross Championship like no one was surprised he was going to do on Saturday night. I'm thrilled for that. I know Ryan Dungey and Red Bull KTM are thrilled for that. And it really, I felt like it was appropriate in a way, because the last guy not named Ryan Villopoto to win a championship in Monster Energy Supercross was, Ryan Dungey. I mean, it's the perfect bookend to an era.
Well, the perfect bookend to an era. And, I wonder now if some of the other competitors are going to legally change their name to Ryan. Seems to be that seems to be a performance advantage in that division for some unexplicable reason. But no, they're just two of the best ever. And you and I were talking last night, Jacob, about Villopoto and him finally getting a win over there, in the world scene. And it's, I don't know that necessarily Ryan Villopoto has lived up even maybe to his own expectations at that level quite yet. But I do know that I believe with time he will. And I also think Ryan Dungey getting the win and the getting the championship is very appropriate just because of the overall season that he's had. And I wonder how much longer, honestly, we're going to see Ryan Dungey keep doing this before he might get an itch to go and either try his hand at something else or maybe even follow in Villopoto's path and maybe go see what he could do on the big stage. There's only so much you can accomplish that, and I think he's pretty much done it all.
Wow. I didn't expect to hear you say that, Tom, but boy, that certainly would open some topics for discussion now, wouldn't it?
You look at some of the other guys before him that have gone over, tried stock cars or gone, done other things. I mean, you got to think, how much longer is he going to keep doing what he's doing here? He's won a couple of championships, won a bunch of races. Especially if Villopoto starts to get on a roll, you got to look at Ryan Dungey and ask yourself, is he going to want to test his mettle in that scenario? I just think it'll be interesting to watch. And it's not as if Dungey is miles better than the competition he's running against either. These are some great racers, Jacob. He just right now is still at the top of his game.
Valid point, and I will take that. I will also make the point that Villopoto currently sits fourth in the standings, only 27 points out of the lead, which shockingly is held by Clement DeSalle and not Max Nagel, who has won three of the first six motos of the season. So you talk about consistency. DeSalle's not finished off the podium in anything yet, and that has given him the advantage. But Villopoto was 4-4 in the most recent round of competition in Argentina. He's not forgotten how to ride that bike, and the three guys that are ahead of him in points points are the three guys that finished ahead of him on the racetrack in both motos during the Argentina round. So Villopoto's getting there, and we've still got a lot of racing left to do in that side. Not a whole lot of racing left to do on the Monster Energy Supercross side, however. Las Vegas is fast approaching. We'll bring the West and the East together for one final shootout. And speaking of the West, I want to give a call to Cooper Webb locking up the 250 West Championship, because that's a young man who had everything thrown at him and still, Tom, managed to come out on top.
Yeah, no question about that. I mean, you know, you talk about overcoming obstacles. Yeah, that's just...
I think Cooper overcame a bunch of them. I can think of a couple of times where he went down and shouldn't have won races and still just flat out drove everybody.
Yeah, exactly. I agree totally. And that's part of what being a champion is. You've got to be able to, you know, you turn an obstacle into an opportunity. And we so many of the greatest champions in any form of auto racing, you can look at situations where they did exactly that. They had bad luck and somehow turned it into an opportunity, whether it was that day or, you know, at some point down the road. And certainly you could say that about Cooper for sure.
Staying on the dirt in just a minute, we will get a chance to catch up with the guy who impressed me all weekend long and picked up the win in the doubleheader USCS United Sprint Car Series weekend in the Carolinas. Tom, Eric Riggins does what he does best around the Charlotte area. He won at Carolina Speedway on Friday night. He won at Lancaster Super Speedway on Saturday night and got some redemption for the race where he was leading with six to go and the car just broke last year. It was an impressive showing, and the Fast 47 is living up to his moniker, because there was nobody touching that car either night. So one of those moments where you sit back, look at it, and go, hey, we won, and we were the best car, and the best car went to victory lane, Tom.
Absolutely right. When you look at it and you say, somebody get out the broom and sweep a couple of really tough races, that certainly is the definition of that. And if you can, I don't care what discipline of racing you're in, if you can go out and you can run strong and you can win two or three on a weekend in the same division, you are really doing something.
And he's got 10 all time now. So we'll continue talking USCS in just a moment. Right now, we're going to do some business and have more of Motorsports Madness around the turn right after this. You are listening to the Madness right here on PMN, the Performance Motorsports Network.
How would you like to win a brand new Corvette? Larry O's got all the details.
WinYourNewCar.com, enter America's number one dream car giveaway contest. At WinYourNewCar.com, complete the puzzle the fastest and win a new Corvette tax-free. Come on, stop dreaming. Start driving with WinYourNewCar.com.
We're growing like crazy and need account reps who know their way around agencies, the internet, and social media. Got connections? Or do you know how to get to the decision makers? Are you fearless? We need you. Internet radio, or as we call it, wireless mobile radio, is rapidly becoming the place to be with almost limitless income potential. So contact us to get involved with the fastest growing professionally produced group of internet radio stations in the world. Your imagination is the only limit here. Call 717-749-0444. That's 717-749-0444. Or you can email us at scorpionradiogroup@gmail.com. You want to ask for Sue.
You hear that? That's the sound of America's only sports car. That's right. It's a Corvette. But not just any Corvette. It's your Corvette. It's that who cares if there's traffic part of your day. And this can be you when you come to Cooper Corvettes. With 60 years of Corvettes to choose from, there's always a Corvette in your budget. And they'll service any Corvette you bring in. Cooper Corvettes on Route 1 just north of Quantico and Triangle. Call, click, or visit CooperCorvettes.com.
You wouldn't trust your taxes to an uncertified accountant. So why trust your vehicle to an uncertified technician? When you have to take your car into the shop, look for the blue and white ASE sign. That ASE blue seal means the shop employs technicians certified by the National Institute for Automotive Service Excellence. ASE certification is proof that technicians have the knowledge and experience to fix your vehicle right the first time. For more information on finding an ASE Blue Seal of Excellence facility, visit the website at www.ase.com.
My very first movie, it was called British Terabithia, and that was a film that a lot of kids loved.
From IamSecond.com.
It felt very cool in my heart to know that I did something nice.
Actress Bailey Madison.
I don't want it to be about me. I want it to be about God. Even though you have an earth father, he is your father, that you can say to him, God, I'm not feeling too well today. Or if it's just, you know, little things like, I feel homesick here. I need you, Lord. I need to feel happiness in my heart. The most important thing is you have to have hope. You have to have faith. God is with you, and God is with you every step of the way. If you give yourself to God and you say, I'm ready to commit myself to you, you will know that God is watching you. He looks down and he goes, I'm very, very happy with what you just did. My name is Bailey Madison, and I am Second.
Time to get back to tonight's Motorsports Madness. Here are the only three of a kind that beats a full house. Jacob Seelman, Tom Baker, and Kyle Magda.
I'm not sure if I would put myself in the conversation for three of a kind at this stage, but hey, Tom, I think I finally figured out why I've been so wacky tonight. I think I was just sniffing too many methanol fumes this weekend.
Oh, yeah, that's what it was. Definitely. Yeah, that stuff is hazardous to your health, you know.
Nah, but it's good for adrenaline. Welcome back to the
Madness. Sure is.
And speaking of all of us at the round table being crazy, I've got somebody who had about as much of a dose of methanol on the weekend as I did. But hey, he was doing a little bit more than I was and going out and winning races. Eric Riggins joins us on the line now to talk a little bit of USCS racing. And Eric, we talked about the numbers Friday and Saturday, but I'll rehash. 10 wins all time for you. You're tied for 10th with Anthony Nicholson, and you sweep the weekend for the second time in your career in the Carolinas. So have you guys stopped celebrating since Saturday night?
Oh, yeah. You know, reality sets in when you come on a Monday and you got to wash everything up, and it's back to normal, and there's not so many people around you. So everybody likes to be in the victory lane picture, but there ain't many people here for wash day.
It's wash day, but I know you had a lot of fun this weekend and picked up the victory, especially Friday night. I know that was big for you. Won at Carolina for the fourth time in your career. How big is it every time you get to go right 20 minutes from home and pick up the win in front of the hometown crowd who really has gotten used to you climbing the fence?
That was definitely cool. It was, you know, a little bit more difficult this time. I know we struggled about all night. We looked, a lot of people were coming up to me, what's going on? Because, you know, usually we go out there and we just put it on them. And this year was a little different with a new track surface, and I wasn't quite as comfortable with it. But we showed up when it counted, and we finally got the car under me there for the feature, and there was no looking back at that point. And it seemed like we were back to our normal selves and doing what we should be able to do at our home track.
I was going to ask about that, Eric, if Jacob didn't. How much different was it with the new track surface? Can you give us an idea of what adjustments you had to make in terms of driving the car on the wider track versus what you were used to?
Yeah, it shocked me the first time I went around the track how different it was. You know, I thought, you know, oh, okay, they're bringing the track in, so it won't be too much of a, you know, roadblock in our way. So I went up with our normal setup, and the new dirt they put on it was actually, you know, had so much more bite that we just had we were freeing the car up all night. And driving wise, track's shorter, but where I ended up running the feature, I feel like was closer to where we usually run, because that's where I had the, you know, where I was able to get the car where it was settled down enough, you know, through all the wet stuff. And the, you know, it was a little bit rough because I had so much rain during the week and the dirt was soft, but you know, once I got back in rhythm, you know, that was the main thing. I had such a good rhythm there before, and it's real, you know, you got to keep your momentum up at the track. So once I was able to do that, it seemed like we were just checked out at that point.
I was going to ask you how much of it was the car's setup and how much of it was sort of your mental programming, you know, from all the times that you run there in the past. It sounds like it was a little bit of both. Sounds like you needed to make some adjustments to the car, but also you needed to kind of get reacquainted from a driving perspective and just kind of get yourself settled down a little bit and figure out where you needed to be.
Yeah, it was. I know every time I came in, I was very unhappy with the car. And, you know, I just started, we changed, you know, a bunch of stuff every time we got off track. And that usually doesn't turn into good results when you just start throwing stuff at it. But the more we went in one direction, the better we got. And so once we got that, and then it made me a lot more comfortable behind the wheel and I was happy with it, then I could go to work and do my job.
Well, this looked in a lot of ways at the end of it all. This weekend looked a lot like the typical Carolina swing weekend for you, where you just kind of went and cleaned everybody's clocks. But in reality, it was a lot more of a challenge for you to get back to that point than what a lot of the fans may have realized.
Yeah, it definitely was. I know Carolina, you know, didn't quite go as planned, and I was really not sure of it heading into the feature. But there at Lancaster, I know last year I was so good there.
Yeah,
and I didn't feel like anybody could have ran with me. And then this year, we kind of came and did the same thing. So I was really comfortable at Lancaster, and I didn't have any issues there. So that night, you know, I was good with that.
I don't blame you for being good with that, Eric. I know Lancaster was a little bit of redemption, to be honest, as far as that goes. How sweet was it after knowing that you had the win in the bag last year and losing it there when the car dropped out of gear with six to go and having to watch Lance Moss celebrate in victory lane? How satisfying was it for you to know that he was behind you this time and picking up that checkered flag?
It was definitely, you know, a little bit of redemption. But then again, I felt like that we just executed like we needed to. And when that happens, I don't think, you know, that I would have been, you know, more excited about this one than another one. But I definitely really excited to win at Lancaster. The fans are awesome there. They seem to like me for some odd reason. But I hope I put on a little bit of a show, even though we kind of stunk it up there in the feature. But I was definitely happy to do that for sure.
And one of those things where now you look going forward just a little bit, Eric. I mean, you've been so dominant in the early season. I don't know that I'm used to seeing you this good this early, except for maybe at Carolina. So where do you take this momentum to now as far as going forward into May and into the summer months is?
Well, I mean, I think it's just we found it at the end of the year before last, where we won at Cherokee and Carolina. And we swept those, and then last year, you know, I felt like we had a good grip on Carolina, like we could have won that race, and then we should have won Lancaster, and then, you know, I can throw out, you know, three or four more races where we should have won, where we had failures or, you know, motor problems, and I just felt like last year we couldn't get into a good rhythm, and, you know, with the rainouts at the end of the year, and I think, you know, we had the same good car, and then I feel like I really got a good setup under it. We've got a good shock package under it. JRI shocks, they've worked with me for, you know, the last 3-4 years, and I feel like we've really got a great program right now. So I think that's a big factor in it, and, you know, I'm not scared to say I should be in contention to win everywhere I go, whether it be Pennsylvania or, you know, Midwest or anywhere. So I'm happy with where we're at.
Well, that's what I kind of want to know is, you know, where are you planning to run the rest of the year? What and are you looking at some point to maybe make the step up and try the Outlaws or try one of the other 410 series? Or are you happy just to kind of run an Outlaw schedule and do what you're doing?
No, we definitely try not to get tied down. And, you know, we don't want to look at any points. We've done our points racing there early in my career, and, you know, we know how that stuff ends up. It really, we'll probably run the whole Southern schedule with Pete and the USCS as long as it doesn't interfere with any big money races we may have on our schedule in Pennsylvania and stuff. But I definitely, you know, every year I want to hit more and more big shows. And right now with our 360s, basically what we have, and We have a new one that's going to be fresh here in a couple of weeks, and we'll be able to do more traveling to big shows with that. So, and that's where we are there. And then our 410, we're in the process of getting it under control. It's together, but we definitely had issues with it at the end of last year when we tried to run Charlotte. But if we get that together, you know, I wouldn't count us out of running any of the big shows with that. And, you know, Central Pennsylvania, I love racing up there with them. And definitely want to run a Charlotte race with the Outlaws, stuff like that, wherever we can.
And, Eric, I got to go back to one more thing here and harass you for a second before I give you the sponsor question and let you get on out of here. But I was joking with you about climbing the fence at Carolina, and you took the safe way down. You climbed down the flag stand instead of going back down the fence like we're so used to you doing every time you win at Carolina. What's up with that?
After Carolina, I was pretty tired. I mean, I had to ride the Bucking Bull there for that 30 laps. You know, I was running straight through the rough stuff where, you know, nobody else would get up there and run, and that's how I was able to make my speed. So I wore myself out pretty good, and once I got to the top of the fence and, you know, I did my little deal, I felt like I deserved, you know, a little bit of a walk down there, as you will.
Fair enough, and I know you can't do it by yourself. Yeah, I give you the question every weekend, but we'll give it to you here as well. Eric, who makes it happen for you in the Fast 47 team?
Definitely got to thank Alpha Canvas and All In Race Products, all your canvas needs, and JRI Shocks. They supply the shocks from our car, and they, you know, we work with them a lot with getting our R&D together, and we've really got that good program helping us. And then we got FSR radiators. I've never run hot. They have some of the best products too. You know, you wouldn't believe what they make. And J&J Auto Racing, the car. I couldn't do it without that car. That car has been golden to me. And then Brown and Miller Racing, the hosing and everything on the car. And FK Rod Ends, they keep all my. I've never had a rod end failure with them, and that's the best stuff you can get. And you know, everybody that does help me. Dylan helps me on the motor stuff, and my mom, my dad. I definitely couldn't do it with them. And couldn't do it without the Lord, and we wouldn't be here without him, so I couldn't do it without that.
And it's definitely, Eric, again, always fun to talk with you, fun to watch you on the racetrack. Real quickly, in the last couple of seconds, what's the next race on the schedule for you? Where can fans look to see you coming up here?
We were looking at USCS this weekend. I'm still unsure on that, but if we don't run that, we'll definitely be at Traveler's Rest, I believe, with USCS, and then I think he has a TBA, so... still unsure of that.
That's Eric Riggins. And again, congratulations to him on a weekend sweep in the Carolinas. We'll stay with the dirt, and Steve Oven's going to join us after this to talk World of Outlaws and a whole lot more. You're listening to Motorsports Madness right here on the Performance Motorsports Network.
How would you like to win a brand new Corvette? Larry O's got all the details.
Enter America's number one dream car giveaway contest at winyournewcar.com. That's right, winyournewcar.com. Complete the puzzle the fastest and win a new Corvette tax-free delivered to your door. Come on, stop dreaming and start driving with winyournewcar.com.
You hear that? That's the sound of America's only sports car. That's right, it's a Corvette. But not just any Corvette. It's your Corvette. It's that who cares if there's traffic part of your day. And this can be you when you come to Cooper Corvettes. With 60 years of Corvettes to choose from, there's always a Corvette in your budget. And they'll service any Corvette you bring in. Cooper Corvettes on Route 1 just north of Quantico and Triangle. Call, click, or visit CooperCorvettes.com.
Before a disaster turns your family's world upside down, it's up to you to be ready. Get a kit. Make a plan. Be informed. Learn how at www.ready.gov. Brought to you by the Federal Emergency Management Agency and the Ad Council.
On the air, you may know me as the Man About Motorsports. Actually, I've been the Man About Insurance for over 30 years. With one call, I can cover your life, health, auto, home, and business insurance. Recently, I saved a young couple over $500 on their annual car insurance bill. No gimmicks and no green lizard. So if you think your insurer is really your good neighbor who is on your side because he is holding your money in his good hands, think again. Call me, 703-631-8000. I have dozens of insurance companies waiting to give you the protection you need and deserve. It may take more than 15 minutes, but you'll receive sound advice, quality professional service, and an honest opinion. That number again, 703-631-8000. Ask for Larry O.
Did you know that birthday parties help build confidence in kids?
Yeah. Did you know that giving kids less sugar before bedtime helps them sleep better?
Oh, totally. Did you know that friendly kids have more friends?
Everybody knows that.
Hey, guys, did you know that most people think they're using the right car seat for their kid, but they're not?
I didn't know that.
Parents who really know it all know for sure that their child is in the right car seat at the right age and size. Visit safercar.gov/the right seat to make sure your child is protected.
Coming to Tampa Bay, I said we want to win a Super Bowl, and I believe we will.
From IamSecond.com.
We came close, but never really did win that championship.
Former NFL head coach Tony Dungy.
At the end of my 6th year, I was fired, and it was one of the biggest disappointments of my life. Next year, I'm in Indianapolis, get to the playoffs, but get knocked out again. And for the next couple of years, it's the same thing. Everyone is saying Colts are never going to win one. And I did wonder, why didn't it pan out the way I thought it would? But I determined that I had to have Christ first, and that everything else came below that, including my own desires. The next year, that ended up being our year to go to the Super Bowl and win it. And it was a wonderful feeling. Every decision I make, I'm going to make it through the lens of Jesus Christ, and he'd guide us to that ultimate victory.
Watch Tony's story at IamSecond.com.
Hi, the kids. It's time to get dirty on Speed 77 Radio's Motorsports Madness. Here are your hosts, Jacob, Tom, and Kyle, with Turn 5 Live's curator of Casa de Pork Chop, Stephen Oven.
And let's just clarify, after the night we've had, that James Pike is also here at the roundtable partaking in the craziness. Welcome back to Motorsports Madness. Jacob Seelman, Tom Baker, Kyle, James, and Steve-O on the line with us. And Steve, I'm glad you're here, but I also have to ask, have you survived the volleyball game?
Well, I thought it was appropriate that I get to play in the dirt on the weekend at the racetrack. So I figured, why not play volleyball and get dirty during the week, too? I mean, it works out.
It does work out, and we're glad to have you. Glad you have survived your sport and are able to now talk sports with us. Specifically, the fact that the World of Outlaws have had a bizarro week, kind of like we've had on the show tonight. Wednesday night at Placerville, Brad Sweet, I'm sure, was ready to just get it done with and forget about it, because we had 4 flips, and 2 drivers end up going to the hospital in the form of Darren Pittman and Jason Johnson. For those who haven't heard, Jason Johnson has a compression fracture in his back that's putting him out for about 3 months. Darren Pittman's got a broken collarbone that's putting him out everything I've read, estimated 6 to 8 weeks or so. And Steve, you've got Jason Myers and Cody Dara filling in those 2 cars, but more importantly, you've got a pretty much paved golden road for Donnie Schatz right to the championship now.
Absolutely, and that, you know, that started Wednesday at Placerville, and you know that wasn't enough for Donnie Schatz, and Jacob, this is incredible. Not even the flu could hold Donnie Schatz down. I mean, it's probably a bit of a cliche, but, you know, there is the saying that, you know, we find out what we're made of when we're given a challenge or when we're down, you know, when we don't feel well or something negative is pushing against us. And I think Saturday or Sunday night, Donnie Schatz showed us exactly what he's made of. Battling the flu, and what I'm hearing is actually possibly a second bout of flu for Donnie. He comes back, races Delansky for the win, gets the win. I believe that's number 5 on the season for him now. And as though losing Pittman and Johnson, you know, for you know, the period of time that they're not going to be on the tour, now Donnie goes out and wins another race, and it's really interesting, because we typically think of Donnie Schatz going on that summer tear where he can just you know, as the temperatures get up there and we get to some tracks that are hard, slick, packed down tracks, that's when we think of Donnie Schatz really turning it on. And I'm impressed right now with the fact that they're being so good in the beginning of the season. You know, the last couple of championship runs for Schatz, they've turned it on in the summer and pulled away. Now we're seeing a whole new side of this team. And I mean, I would love to see somebody get up there and really give them a challenge for it. And I'm not counting anybody out. But, boy, after that performance Sunday night, battling the flu, I mean, what can't this team do right now?
That's exactly right. And it's you stop and think about this and the fact that they've got a 30-point lead over Shane Stewart. And I say it's a paved road for Schatz to the championship only because I'm still not convinced that Shane and that team are capable of holding the early season consistency that they've got all the way through the summer. So, you know, it's going to be interesting to see that. But, you know, Pittman, we've seen be Schatz's chief contender for the title the last couple of years. And even taking it from him in 2013, Steve, for him to be out of that number nine machine for Casey Kane Racing, it's going to be tough. And I found it almost ironically appropriate that Cody Darrow was the one to get the call to fill in after they told Darrow, you don't have a place here because we don't have money to put you in a car. And he's going and running on the All-Stars Tour this season with his family team.
Well, I'll tell you, I know, you know, Jacob, you and Tom both have spoke to me regarding, you know, how positively you guys have felt about Cody Darrow as a person, not just on the racetrack. And it really set me back in the seat to really think about this. This really comes full circle for Cody because, like you said, you know, at the beginning of this season, you know, we figured out here in the off season that, you know, he wasn't going to have a place there because of sponsorship. And it would be, you know, for some that just make a quick judgment about it, you would say, you know, well, why would he want to do that after, you know, they remove him from the ride because of sponsorship? And it would have been easy for him to just say, you know what, I'm with my family team again. We're doing the All-Star thing, and that's what we're going to do. And it would have been really easy for him to turn that offer down, but I really applaud Cody for, I mean, he really is stepping up right now for Casey Kane Racing to fill in for Darren Pittman, and I'm thinking that, you know, it's going to be at least 6 weeks before we see Darren, you know, even think about getting back on the track. You know, when you break the collarbone, you really got to give that the appropriate time it needs to heal, because what you don't want to have happen is to have, you know, the bones not heal right, or sometimes what can happen is when the two bones come together, they come together, but they don't fully heal. And that in a medical terminology is called a non-union. So you don't want that to happen because then you have to go back in, re-break the original break that didn't heal right. And that would just be a mess for those guys. So they're really going to have to take their time with Darren coming back. That's for sure.
Yeah, they are. They've got to get it right. They can't afford to have him not heal properly and be worse off later in the season when it really matters. So moving away from the Outlaws, they're going to wrap up the California West Coast Swing this weekend at what was formerly Kings Speedway and now has new naming under sponsorship, and the Paris Auto Speedway, the traditional end to the Western Swing for the World of Outlaws. But, Steve, that wasn't the only major dirt track racing going on this weekend. We had the rescheduled Hard Clay Open for the Brett Day-promoted Short Track Super Series over the weekend. And how appropriately, who wins it but the guy who ends up winning, I don't know, every other big race for dirt track racing, whether it's in a sprint car or a modified or, you know, anything else but Stuart Friesen. How appropriate is this?
Oh, it's so appropriate. I recently talked to his new wife, Jessica Zemkin, now known as Jessica Zemkin Friesen, and she was telling me that, you know, with the season both of them had last year, they won just about every big money race in the Northeast, whether it was in a modified or a sprint car. And they said that, you know, they right now they just have to wake up every day and pinch themselves. They just started a brand new business together, which is getting a lot of support from the racing community. So it's just it was so appropriate that Stewart ends up getting yet another win on the Dirt Modified Tour. And that was the first event for the Short Track Super Series that Brett Dale holds. Now, you turn around the next day after winning the Hard Clay Open, took home over $5,500 in prize and lap money on Saturday. Turn around on Sunday, they make the stretch down I-86 to the 5 Mile Point Speedway, where Danny Johnson picks up the win in the feature, but more importantly, Stuart Friesen locks up the 2014 Race of Champions Dirt Modified Crown. That was a race that was rained out from the end of last year. That was supposed to be held in November and was just rescheduled for Sunday. So Friesen beats out Matt Sheppard by only 4 points to get the championship. So pretty good weekend for Stuart Friesen, no doubt about it.
Yeah, pretty good weekend indeed, Steve, and one that I know he will remember for a long time to come and will continue to cement his legacy as far as one of the greatest dirt track racers of the modern era that I at least have seen in a long time. So we go Short Track Super Series racing and talking about the modifieds, and we're getting ready here in, I believe it's just about a week or so, you know, a handful of days now, to go Super Dirt Car Series racing for the kickoff of their 2015 season.
Yes, that's coming up on the 25th of April, Saturday night out at the Fulton Speedway, the High Bank Holdup event there. It's going to be the first event for the Super Dirt Car Series. We talked about Stuart Friesen. He's going to be in a brand new ride this year with Tyler Seary Racing. He's actually going to be coming out to our home track, the Blackrock Speedway, on the 24th, the night before, to race in our opening night event. To get that car, you know, to get Stuart time in that car so that the first time he sits down in the ride isn't the first Super Dirt Car Series event. So they're going to be up the night before to test and tune. Then we've got the first event there at Fulton for the series. I look at all of the gypsum cars, Larry White, Billy Decker, and of course you can't rule out Jimmy Phelps, any of the HBR cars. Matt Sheppard won the Outlaw 200. In October last year. Jimmy Phelps Fulton is really his home track, and now he's going to be in HBR equipment, whether it's a weekly track or the Super Dirt Car Series. And I think that is going to prove dividends for both Jimmy Phelps and the HBR team. And don't be surprised if the 98H is the first one to etch his name in victory lane in 2015.
And really quickly, one more big point from the weekend. Mother Nature claimed Duck River for the World of Outlaws late models, but we finally got a race in after the Florida swing, and we go to Tazewell Speedway. Billy Ogle Jr., last lap pass, tops Josh Richards, picks up his first career series win.
Yeah, two points there. 3 points. We love first-time winners. We love last lap passes. And we love seeing Josh Richards run up front in his return to the full late model series. And we got all three of those over the weekend.
We did get all three of them, Steve. And always appreciate you stopping by the madness. Go back to your volleyball game and we'll catch you loose. We're going to take our final commercial break. And when we come back, we'll make performance picks headed into a big weekend in Bristol and wrap up this crazy show here on the Performance Motorsports Network.
How would you like to win a brand new Corvette? Larry O's got all the details.
In the Pits Media is proud to present its newest partner, WinYourNewCar.com. That's right, you now can enter the number one American dream car contest giveaway at WinYourNewCar.com. Complete the puzzle the fastest and win a new Corvette tax-free, delivered to your door. Come on, stop dreaming, start driving with WinYourNewCar.com.
Car problems? You can trust your local Kottmann man. Kottmann has a 40-year history as a leader in car repair and making happy, satisfied customers. Whatever's wrong with your car, SUV, or truck, Kottmann will check it out free using state-of-the-art diagnostic equipment. Don't take chances with your car. Bring it to Kottmann and let your local Kottmann man show you why they are America's transmission and total auto care experts. Visit Kottmann.com to download money-saving coupons. Kottmann,
Real service, real fast.
You know that phone call is going to come at the worst possible time, right at the end of the game. Fourth quarter, fourth down, and 1 yard to go. They're piling up, but you can't watch that. You got to get that car off the road. This could have been prevented if you have taken advantage of Cotman's free TransCheck 21. Here's a chance to have us look at your car and head off any problems that could happen that could interrupt that game. Again, it's a free check. Come see us.
See Leonard and the fine folks at Cotman of Manassas, 9113 Mathis Avenue in Manassas. Give them a call at 703-365-7200.
Before a disaster turns your family's world upside down, it's up to you to be ready. Get a kit. Make a plan. Be informed. Learn how at www.ready.gov. Brought to you by the Federal Emergency Management Agency and the Ad Council.
If you're a gearhead, you probably go online to those hot rod superstores, drooling over the chrome and speed goodies until you find just the right item for your muscle car, tuner car, truck. But what do you do when it comes to fixing the mom mobile? If you're like most do-it-yourselfers, you head to the strip mall parts store and talk to the "Do you want fries with that?" kid behind the counter. Hold on, Bunky. Did you stop to think where those chain stores are getting the parts that you're installing in the vehicle that's used to transport your family everywhere? They get the cheapest suppliers they can find to sell you the parts at bargain prices. They're limited lifetime warranties. What a joke. Remember the last time mom's car broke down? You heard about that one for weeks. Don't take that chance again. Excelsior Racing has the quality parts you need for your family vehicle. Parts that you can install knowing you're getting the best for your family. Excelsior Racing. Quality parts. Personalized service. Affordable pricing. Fast to you direct. Excelsior Racing. Online at ExcelsiorRacing.com or call 502-909-2034.
Hi, everybody. This is Geddy Lee for RAD. To many of us, drunk driving is something that other people do. Certainly not one of our friends or relatives would do such a thing. When you see someone who's had too much to drink, about to get into a car, urge them to give up the keys and find alternate transportation. Always choose a designated driver. Remember, music lives. You should, too.
A public service message brought to you by the U.S. Department of Transportation, RAD, the National Association of Broadcasters, and the Ad Council.
Hi, this is Ryan Priest, driver of the number 6 TS Haulers, modified in the Wheel and Modified Tour. Now back to Speed 77 Radio's Motorsports Madness on PMN, the Performance Motorsports Network.
And we are back here on the Performance Motorsports Network with the final segment of this edition of the Madness. Jacob Seelman, Tom Baker, Kyle Magda, and James Pike back at our respective places around the round table, ready to rock and roll towards what I think, Tom, is going to be the most exciting weekend of racing so far in 2015. You know why? It's Bristol, baby.
Well, I mean, Bristol always brings a level of excitement and certainly a level of anticipation for sure. Will be interesting to see just how things work out up there. A lot of stuff going on at Bristol this week. The K&M Pro E Series in action as well up there, and that's going to be one of the marquee races for them for the year. It's a track that everybody looks forward to in that series and wants to do well at. So, yeah, there's only one Bristol, and you know, hopefully Mother Nature will cooperate and everything will go off as intended, and it will be some great racing up there.
That is what I am hoping for. I am also looking at the official points sheet right now. And as far as all of our guys who sit back and look and smile and say that, hey, we did some good things over the weekend. Nobody did more good things than our New England correspondent, Kyle Souza, who is not at the roundtable but picked Jimmy Johnson correctly to win on Saturday night. So that would mean the torch falls to me, who picked Kevin Harvick to finish second, as the guy who goes last. That leaves a tie, as a matter of fact, between Mr. Baker and Mr. Magda. And Tom, considering you, sir, are the lowest in points of all us full-timers, you get to go first.
Gee, thanks.
by the way, just to recap, since there's no IndyCar race or anything spectacular or special like that, all we have to worry about is the Xfinity and Cup races this weekend.
And if you're new to our audience, this is something we do amongst ourselves at Race Chaser Online, just purely for our own amusement. And we just involve you in it each week so you can laugh at those of us who totally got it wrong and hopefully say something nice about those of us who get it right. In this case, it was Kyle Susa. He's not here, so no need to praise him. Just feel sorry for me because I stink so far this year. I'm looking for my first win, and Darrell Waltrip retired a long time ago, so I can't pick him to win at Bristol. He used to do that about every time they went there.
And Kyle Busch isn't in the field this weekend either, so you can't use that.
And Kyle Busch isn't in the field. I picked Kurt Busch the last few weeks because, boy, I thought he was on a run, and he just didn't get there for me, so I'm going to get off of the Kurt Busch bandwagon for a week, and I'm going to go with a driver who certainly is not afraid to mix it up when he has to. And this, I think this is a pretty safe pick for the Cup, at least in terms of he should be up front contending for the win, going with Brad Keselowski in the Blue Deuce to get the win, or whatever color they decide to paint it this week. In the Xfinity Series, I really don't want to pick any Cup guys. I just don't. I'd rather not win the Xfinity points than pick a Cup guy to win an Xfinity race. And Eric Ouch. Jones got me out of that run that had been going on. You know what? This week, in the Xfinity Series, I'm going to take a real flyer here. I'm going to pick Regan Smith, and I say that's a flyer because this is not necessarily a track where you would probably pick Regan to win, but he's been the story of almost so far. He's been fast, but when it comes down to race time, it's just something always trips him up somehow, some way, and you find him back, you know, at the back end of the top five or, you know, seventh through 10th. I'm going to pick Regan Smith this week and go with him to win the Xfinity race.
Wow. Okay. That's interesting. I didn't see that one coming. I'm just going to kind of okay and nod my head and say, sure, Tom, and
none
go
of my
right along.
Been winning.
Nah, fair enough. Magda, you're next.
Alrighty, guys. Took Kurt Busch last week, and Tom, when you were responding to my Facebook post about Kurt Busch, I did pick Kurt Busch as well. So we both had a good start to the weekend at Texas, but didn't pan out. But been going back to Bristol. Two guys I'm picking this weekend, both looking for their first points-paying wins on the season. The Cup Series, this guy has not won since 2013. Hard to believe in the Cup Series. And it may have been – actually, no, it was Loudon was his last win in September 2013. So I'm going to say that, you know what, Joe Gibbs Racing is going to continue their short track dominance. I'm going to go with another driver in that stable. I'm going to go with the 20 of Matt Kenseth to win on Sunday. Now, for the Xfinity race, not many Cup drivers in the race, but there is one guy you guys did not bring up yet, and he did win the last time we were at Bristol. Number 22, Ryan Blaney, is going to get the job done on Saturday, and I really think being so close at Las Vegas a few weeks ago, I really think he'll get the job done on Saturday.
James, I'm going to let you go, and I'm also going to warn these two that I'm going to spoil their parties because I had my picks made on Sunday night in the spreadsheet, so I don't care that they've both used two of my picks already. I'm still making them, and they're just going to have to deal with it. But in the meantime,
there's a large part of me that now hopes, not for their sake, but for yours, that backfires in your face. But, yeah.
You know what? Just pick.
Yeah. So in
ouch.
Yeah. And that's nothing on you. It's just I like to try and play this in a sporting manner and try and not copy everybody else's picks on the same
week.
So
do I, James.
So thank you, Magda. Thank you. But as far as Xfinity goes, I feel like, especially since, if my memory serves me correctly, I'm highest in the Xfinity standings than I am in anything else, that it makes sense for me to go points racing this week, especially since Bristol can be a little bit unpredictable. And I like the thought of picking a guy whose finishes in the Xfinity series at Bristol read as follows: 3rd, 11th, 4th, and 12th. Average of 7.5 in his four starts in that series there. Give me Austin Dillon in that race because I'm not entirely convinced he's going to win, but so long as nothing crazy happens, I'll be stunned if he isn't somewhere near top five, top 10, and that's exactly what I need. As for the Cup side of things, I feel like I've been on the fringe and tried to pick this driver a few times this season and have at the last moment gone with somebody else. This week, I think I'm actually going to take him, especially since he's got an average finish of 10 and 3/4, if we like fractions, in the past four races here. And, oh, by the way, he may or may not have won the race last August here as well. And if he does this and proves me right on Sunday, he'll become the first guy to win the August and then the March race next season back-to-back since his teammate, Brad Keselowski. So, Joey Logano will be my pick for Sunday's race. The, I believe, Steve Burns. No, what is it? It's Food City 500 supporting Steve Burns and Stand Up to Cancer. Also, since this will probably be the last time I'm on the mic, I also just want to throw a very quick shout-out to Romain Grosjean, who did a very, very honorable thing, I think, at the Chinese Grand Prix by dedicating his points haul to Jules Bianchi, who is still fighting in the ICU after his crash in Japan in October. I thought that was a very, very wonderful thing on Romain's part. So good on him and the boys at Lotus for looking after a fellow Frenchman.
Agreed. I definitely I like that. And that's one of those things that, you know, you just you take it in the moment and go with it. And I was very glad to hear that that Roman did that, and again, I think all of us sending still well wishes out to Jules Bianchi and hoping for his ultimate recovery, just kind of waiting and seeing on that. But since everybody's been yelling at me in our behind-the-scenes chat the last couple minutes, and I'm electing not to listen to them because I've had my picks set for the past 24 hours, y'all are just going to have to deal with it. Ryan Blaney is going back-to-back at Bristol. And I'm sorry, the two words that epitomize Bristol, bad Brad. Penske sweeps the weekend. Done.
You know, it's beginning to, you're beginning to remind me of NASCAR, the way you just change rules willy-nilly.
Hey, here, there was never a rule saying that we had to wait until the show to make the pick. We just said you can't change the picks after the show.
I just am really, it's not so much that you just jinxed my pick of Keselowski. It's really the
and
fact that you pick Ryan Blaney that bothers me. I'd like to see Ryan get a win.
Excuse me, I'm the jinx. Both of my drivers finished second in Texas. Thank you.
Oh, boo.
You know what Kevin Harvick or Smoke would say about second, don't you?
It's the first loser. Yeah.
Well,
first or last.
You know, guys, I know we're not picking the K&M Pro E Series at Bristol, but I do think it merits a little bit of conversation here only because they are part of that card up there. And, you know, we've been back and forth on our shows this year about drivers who are, you know, really performing well in that series, but you know, going to Bristol, Kyle Magda, I'm calling this one a wild card because I honestly believe that we have no clue who the favorite is going into this. This is going to be an awesome race. Real quick, Kyle, a quick thought.
Keep in mind, Eddie McDonald is in the field and he will try to defend his win. But guys, I will say it right now. The guy I'm going to pick, since Bristol drives like a dirt track, I'm going to go on a limb here. I'm going to say Rico Abreu wins on Saturday.
He went there. He really went there. All right. Yeah, and it's not unsurprising.
I just want to give him a call, you know, a prop, because I just think that series deserves it. It's going to be a great race.
Fair enough. All right. So, guys, checkered flag on this edition of the Madness. But before I close and say goodnight, I do want to make it a point to offer our condolences here on the air to Davenport, Florida, and down there by Walt Disney World, because there was a crash over the weekend with Disney World's version of the Richard Petty exotic driving experience. And one of their driving instructors, 36-year-old Gary Terry out of Davenport, was killed in a crash where the car struck a guardrail, and it was just one of those unfortunate things that happens. And you hate to hear of anything happening like that on the racetrack. You hate it even worse when it's something like that where, you know, people just come to get the experience and get the thrill that the drivers we watch on Saturdays and Sundays experience on a basis every weekend. So our thoughts, prayers, condolences out to the entire Terry family and the entire Richard Petty driving experience family as well. I know a couple of the guys, Tom, that we know work in the RPD family, and they took it really hard over the weekend. So from all of us here at the round table, we're thinking about all of you guys and praying for everyone affected by the situation. But that's going to do it for tonight's edition of Motorsports Madness. So for Kyle, James, Tom, and Big Mike behind the glass, I'm Jacob Seelman, reminding all you race fans out there, keep it off the wall till we meet again, and we just might see you at the racetrack. Good night.
You've been listening to Motorsports Madness with the Speed 77 Radio Race Chaser Online crew. Stay tuned to Performance Motorsports Network for more race talk. For the latest motorsports news, visit racechaseronline.com. Motorsports Madness is a copyrighted production of the Performance Motorsports Network. www.performancemotorsportsnetwork.com. A member of the Scorpion Radio Group, Inc., and may not be rebroadcast, replicated, or saved in any media without the explicit written permission of PMN. Check out our Facebook page or our section on the PMN website. The opinions expressed on this program are those of the host, co-host, and guests, and do not necessarily reflect those of the management and ownership of either the Performance Motorsports Network or Scorpion Radio Group Incorporated, the advertisers, or the marketing partners. Be listening again next week when the madness returns on Monday night at 7 Eastern. Until then, keep it off the wall and keep the shiny side up.